Chapter 2
Golden Rectangles and Spirals.
It was Monday, and Miss Bradley was still ill, so Trapjaw organized all the children into pairs for the field trip.
Jack Smart,
he said, reading the list on his clipboard.
Your partner will be Arnold Bleckensop.
Arnold grinned so widely that his little piggy eyes almost disappeared behind his plump cheeks. He stood close to Jack and began to explain some weird facts about whales. He wasn't a bad kid, but nobody really liked him because he spoiled everybody's games at recess by telling them how they could do things better.
If you kick the soccer ball at precisely this angle...he would say. Then it will curve round into the net.
Show us!
Nathan would shout, but Arnold was no good at soccer, and when he tried to kick the ball, he always fell on his butt while everyone shrieked with laughter and pointed at him. Trapjaw made the children line up in pairs outside the glass-fronted building, which was painted with tropical fish.World of Oceans said the sign above the doorway. Trapjaw walked up and down the line, and nobody dared to whisper or rustle their lunch bag.
Don't forget that this is a math excursion,
he said, looking directly at Jack.
You will use your knowledge to figure out some difficult problems.
First of all, Trapjaw led them all into a classroom that was filled with tables and chairs.On each table were some paper and a box full of pencils, most of them broken or blunt.
Today we are going to discover what the golden ratio is,
he said.
But first, we are going to find out about golden rectangles and golden spirals.
Arnold raised his hand and asked,
Why is everything golden?
Jack blinked in surprise that there was something that Arnold didn't know after all. He was also very relieved because he had wanted to ask the same question.
They are called golden because they are special, unique, and beautiful,
said Trapjaw.
A golden rectangle has certain measurements that are very pleasing to look at. It is often seen in art and in architecture.And we can see one in the famous painting, Mona Lisa, by Leonardo da Vinci.
He held up a picture of the painting.
The measurements for a golden rectangle are taken from the Fibonacci sequence. Jack Smart, do you remember the first few numbers of the sequence?
Jack gulped and tried to think. It started with 1, 2, 3. Or did it? No, there was another one at the beginning.And then, he shook his head, defeated.
1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13,
shouted Arnold.
That is correct,
said Trapjaw.
And you will use these measurements to draw some golden rectangles. You can draw one that is 5 centimeters long and 3 centimeters wide. Or you can draw one that is 8 centimeters long and 5 centimeters wide, and so on.As long as you choose two numbers that are next to each other in the Fibonacci sequence, you will have a golden rectangle.
10 minutes later, Jack had drawn some golden rectangles on his paper. Trapjaw looked at his watch and said,
There is half an hour until lunchtime, so you can discover the next part yourselves. Your task is to find out what a golden spiral is.We'll meet in the lunchroom at 1 p.m. and you can share your findings.
Come on, Jack. Isn't this exciting?
Said Arnold, and he actually grabbed Jack's hand with his plump, sticky one. Jack pulled it free and marched towards a nearby archway, Arnold trotting after him. They went beneath the archway into a gloomy space filled with bubbling tanks and the eerie sound of whales calling to each other.
Welcome to the Pacific Ocean!
Boomed a recorded voice as they entered. Jack was astonished by all the amazing fish in the tanks, and he pressed his nose against the glass, steaming it up with his breath.
"Look at this spiral,"
said Arnold, tapping at the glass of the cabinet packed with shells.
"Perhaps it will help us with our task."
Jack peered at a perfect spiral shell that had been split in half to show the inside. It was separated into smooth, pearly chambers, each slightly larger than the next.
"It's called a nautilus," said Arnold. "And each chamber is bigger than the next by exactly the same proportion. How does a shellfish know how to do that?"
Jack was feeling confused again. As he glanced around the room, he noticed a small table in the corner.
"Hey, look over here! It shows you how to draw a golden spiral!"
Jack led Arnold to the table. They sat down on a tiny pair of chairs. There was a card explaining how to draw a perfect spiral shell. Arnold picked it up, and Jack reached for a piece of paper, a pencil, and a ruler.
"Okay," he said. "Read the instructions to me."
Arnold cleared his throat.
"The first thing you have to do," he said, "is to start with a golden rectangle."
Jack drew a rectangle, just as he'd done earlier. He chose to draw one that was 21 centimeters long and 13 centimeters wide. He was proud that he had remembered the numbers from the Fibonacci sequence. By carefully following Arnold's instructions, Jack drew straight lines to divide the rectangle into squares. He wrote the length inside each square.
"Look at that," he said. The numbers are all from the Fibonacci sequence."
Now came the exciting part. All Jack had to do was to draw smooth curves from one corner to the next. And there it was, a perfect golden spiral.
"You have to admit, that's a pretty cool way of using math," said Arnold, tracing the spiral with his finger. "I suppose it would go on and on to infinity if you could draw it big enough."
There was a sudden blast of music from the next room.
"I'm going to see what that is,"
Jack announced, getting up from his chair. He didn't really want Arnold to come, but Arnold stuck to him like gum on the bottom of his shoe.
"Welcome to the Atlantic Ocean,"
boomed the same voice as they passed through the next archway. This room was divided into different sections, and there was a tank filled with silver fish, gazing at nothing as they swam round in circles.
"You look better as fish and chips,"
Jack told them, tapping on the glass. In the corner was an area that looked like a harbor, with steps up to a pretend pier.
"Welcome to the English seaside,"
thundered the voice. At the far end of the pier was a three-dimensional picture of a fishing village. It must have been made of plastic, with the picture painted on, but it looked incredibly real. Two rows of stone cottages lined a steep cobbled street, which wound down the hill toward a harbor where brightly colored fishing boats were tied up. It almost looked as though you could step into it. A fake road sign stood at the side of the picture, pointing down towards the harbor. "Spiral Bay" were the words printed on it. But someone else was staring at it too. Becky, standing alone, peering into the picture.
"Hey, has your partner left you already?"
Jack said. Becky stuck out her tongue.
"She's gone for lunch already, because she's scared to be even 1 minute late in case Trapjaw gives her some math to do."
"Is it that time already? We'd better go too. You know what he's like about sticking to the rules."
"I'm coming in a minute,"
snapped Becky.
"I'm just looking at this picture."
The minute hand of the clock gave a loud click as it reached the number 12. It was exactly 1 o'clock when a fanfare of trumpets sounded and the first unbelievable thing happened. Becky must have seen it at the same moment as Jack, because all the color drained out of her cheeks. The picture of Spiral Bay had changed.